with webinar system, that is blessing on Corona to Ayurveda, blessing to Ayurveda definitely. And now this program is on YouTube Live. I need your blessings to support any day, because we have standardized our time of webinar generally 4 to 6, when the patient's pressure is much less on doctors. So new generation, old generation, our similar generation, it is an opportunity, golden opportunity to learn everything from the experts like Dr. M. Prasad, Dr. Karthikeyan, Dr. Reena ji, Dr. Raju ji, Dr. Sri Kumari ji is also at everybody who is involving himself is really so much fortunate that every expert is blessing us. Thank you, thank you, thank you for blessing us. Now I would like to hand over the stage to Professor Suhas Kumar Shetty ji. Professor Suhas Kumar Shetty.
Namaste, everybody. A very good evening to all. On behalf of Independent Research Committee, Zandu Imami, Vishwa Ayurveda Parishad and Ayush Darpan, I wholeheartedly welcome you all for 158th webinar called as Ayush Samriddhi. It's a great intention. Dr. Pavan Sharma has an initiative in celebrating Ayurveda every day. And we're glad to join this eminent personalities across the globe for today's webinar. Once again, on behalf of the organizing committee, and especially on behalf of Dr. Pavan Kumar Sharma and all the members of the Independent Ethics Research Society, Zandu Imami, Ayush Darpan, and Vishwa Ayurveda Parishad, I welcome you all for today's webinar. A very interesting session on what Ayurveda can offer in the management of autism. As you all know, that Autistic Pride Day is a pride celebration for autistic people, which is held on June 18th every year. This autistic recognizes the importance of pride for autistic people and its role in bringing the positives in the society. Autistic Pride Day was first celebrated in 2005, who selected June 18th because it was the birthday of the youngest member of the group of that year. As you all know, that autism, also known as autistic spectrum disorder, is a complicated condition that includes problems with the communication and behavior. Autism is an example disorder where we need an interdisciplinary multi-modal approach. And today, we are very lucky and to have experts not only be talking about these models, but also sharing their rich experiences and wisdom and applying these such models in their practice. We are very happy to be joined by 4 speakers for today's session. We are joined by Dr. Reena Kulkarni, President Department of Kumar Vidya, SDM Institute of Ayurveda and Hospital Bangalore. Welcome to you, madam. We are also very fortunate to be joined by Vaidya M. Prasad, owner and the pioneer in the field of autism, who runs the Sunetri Ayurveda Hospital in Thrissur. A hearty welcome to you, sir. We are also very happy to be joined by Dr. N. B. Karthikeyan, a renowned ENT surgeon and passionate about the traditional Indian system of medicine, including Ayurveda and Siddha. On behalf of the organizing committee, I wholeheartedly welcome you, sir. We are also joined by Dr. CMMM Raju, Professor and Head Department of Vidya at Government Ayurveda Medical College, Bengaluru. On behalf of the committee, a warm welcome to you, sir. So without wasting much of the time, now, the first session of the day is by Dr. Reena Kulkarni. Let me briefly introduce Dr. Reena Kulkarni. As mentioned, Dr. Reena Kulkarni, Head, Department of Kaumarabhritya, Institute of Ayurveda, Bangalore. She has teaching and clinical experience of over 14 years. She has published more than 45 scientific articles. She also has to her credit various awards, including Kumara Ratna in 2019. By Association of Ayurvedic Professionals of North America. We're very happy to have you, Dr. Reena, with us. And Dr. Reena, we'll be talking about autism, Ayurveda perspective. I kindly request Dr. Reena enlighten us basic approach and concepts of Ayurveda towards autism. Thank you, madam.
Audible, sir.
Dr. Reena.
Hello, sir.
Yes, madam. You can start your presentation, madam. Yeah. You're audible, madam.
Can you make me a host so that I can share the screen?
Pavan, sir.
She is asking to make her the host, co-host.
Okay.
Dr. Reena Kulkarni.
Done.
Yes, madam.
Yes, sir. Hello. So, sir,
landscape slide mode to be visible.
Yeah,
you can make landscape slide. It is visible on. You can start your presentation.
Is it visible now, sir?
Yes, madam. It is visible and audible. You can start.
Right. Fine, sir. Thank you so much. And first of all, thank you, sir. At the outset, I'd like to thank Zandu Imami, Mr. Pavan Kumar Sharma, Swashiti, sir, all the eminent speakers here, and of course, all the audience. It's a wonderful opportunity for me to share my views with autism. Thank you once again. And let us start with the topic right now. So my job for the day is autism with the perspectives. Now, we all know autism is a majority presents with a neuropsychiatric manifestations. Recently, grouped as autism disorder by identified criteria. Once, what was very rare, you know, the estimates says that in 1985, it was 1 in 2,500. And you see, 1995, the estimate was 1 in 500. And look at the estimates of recent. That is, you can see in 2008, the estimate was 1.59. And recently, 2020, prevalence is 1 in 54. You can imagine the burning issue of autism and the raised prevalence. That's what makes it very important to discuss with this particular topic. And probably we have to congratulate the whole team for selecting this particular event. And you can even see the boys to girl ratio is as much as 5:1. And it is estimated that, you know, $17,000 billion are more required to care baby with autism as children without autism. Okay. deepen into the autism, but one you can see that the warning signs with autism, when to suspect autism. Any child with any symptoms should be for autism. For example, no babbling by 12 months, no gesturing, pointing, by 12 months, no single words by 6 months, no two words spoken together spontaneously by 24 months, and any loss of previously acquired language or social skills at a point of time. Of course, we all know that autism presents with speech and communication disorders too much, along with the behavioral issues and of course the communication problem. Now, considering these main features of autism, now let us quickly step into what Ayurveda speaks about this. Now, there is no direct and explicit description about autism we find in Ayurveda. There are certain terms that are mentioned like anavastita chitta, moha chitta and all, but you cannot directly say that it is autism because there is no detailing about the etiopathological considerations and its manifestations. Let us not to feel about this because Charaka has given a beautiful analogy. He says that nahi sarva vikaranam namatosti dhruva sthiti. So whenever you don't find a name for a disease in our classics, we can use this particular experiment to derive at the conclusions and the etiopathological considerations and the treatments. So that is Vikara Prakriti. Vikara Prakriti refers to the clinical set of clinical manifestations. Adhishtana Antarani refers to the manifestations based upon the science, then samuthana vishesha refers to the etiological considerations. Now, considering a whole lot of literature on autism, we just classify these into like those which are related to bija dosha janya, the genetic factors, those which are related to atma karma sila, then there is again a set of answers. I can turn end up in having this manifestation. Sarvabhatara bhavas, the insults during the intrauterine life, the Vadivega Samudbrahma, which refers to the influences or the secondary to any illness or insults to the developing brain, then of course, develop comments with regards to autism. Some of the evidence for these kind of considerations include studies say that of enamines and with subunits like NR2 and NR2B and CAM are linked, the secondary messenger pathway are observed in autistic brains. Similarly, the single nucleotide polymorphism in the including a glutamate 6 gene mutations with chromosome number 22. In Rett syndrome, it is a trait of autism.
Dr. Suhas.
Hello, Dr. Rina. Hello.
I hope her net connectivity is the problem.
Yeah, I think it was not clear. Maybe I can just call her. Yeah, I think Dr. Rina, you can just reshare your, yeah. Yes. You can continue. Now it's visible. But your voice is not clear, Dr. Rina.
If connectivity is the problem, we can take her lecture in the next.
Okay.
We can.
Yeah. I think, Dr. Rina, is it okay if we can present later? Can we have the presentation now with other speakers? Hello, Dr. Rina? Your slides are visible, but your audio is not clear. I think you need to unmute yourself. Your slides are visible, Dr. Rina, but your voice is not clear. Hello, Dr. Rina?
We can take after next speaker, ma'am.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah. Dr. Rina, is it okay that we can take up your presentation later on? Hello? Am I audible, Dr. Rina? If you can. Either can start presenting or can just stop the sharing.
I think there is some network issues there. She's not getting what you're saying.
Yeah. But because she has to at least take up some other presentation. I think we have some connectivity issues with Dr. Rina. I think we'll join her later on. Now I think we'll move on to the second presentation. Now may I introduce the next speaker for the session? We are very happy to have Vaidya M. Prasad. After his post graduation in Shalaka Tantra from Government Ayurveda College, Thiruvananthapuram, he started working in Sitaram Ayurveda Hospital, Thrissur. And later in 2006, his wife Vaidya Shaniya Verma established their own Ayurveda ashram and research center named Sunetri in Thrissur. He served as principal and medical superintendent of Ashtanga Ayurveda Chikitsalayam and Vidyapeet for 5 years. And he was very fortunate to learn the principles and practice of Ayurveda under the legendary Acharya Padma Bhushana, Vaidya Bhushana K. Raghavan Trimalpad, and also trained under Padma Shri Dr. K. Rajagopalan. He conducts various informal learning and teaching programs called Samikshas. And this year, we are very happy to inform that he is appointed as Guru CRAV program by Rashtriya Ayurveda Vidyapeeth, New Delhi. Dr. M. Prasad has its unique protocol for the management of autism. May I now request Dr. Vaidya M. Prasad to kindly enlighten us with Sunetri protocol for the management of autism. Over to you, sir.
Namaste. And let me start with a salutation. Chaturmukha Samarambham Vakbhadajarya Madhyamam Asmadajarya Paryandam Vande Guru Paramparam. Respected Pavanji, my dear friend Dr. Suhas Shettiji, then the other presenters of this wonderful session, Dr. Reena Kulkarni, Dr. N.P. Karthikeyan, Dr. C.M.M. Raju, other experts, senior Vaidyas present in this webinar. My namaskaram to all of you. First of all, let me express my happiness and gratitude to the organizers of this program, very specially focusing the autism spectrum disorder. Actually, my presentation obviously is a continuation of what Dr. Reena Kulkarni was supposed to present, because I am not going to explain the Ayurvedic concepts behind the understanding of autism spectrum disorder. I'm going to say something about a special protocol which we are working with. So let us hope that the other aspects will be shared by Dr. Kulkarni later. So I'll come to Sunetri protocol. Let me share my slides. Are the slides visible now?
It's visible, thank you.
Okay. Yes, Sunetri protocol for autism. And I'm very happy to specially mention the name of respected Dr. Madan Tangavelu, who gave me another opportunity recently to speak about this protocol in another international webinar. So my special mentioning about the kindness of respected Madanji. Sunetri protocol for autism, or SUPRA, we started it in 2002. And obviously, this protocol got refined many times, because as Dr. Reena Kulkarni was mentioning, we do not have a ready reckoner protocol in Ayurvedic classics like the treatment protocols of many other diseases like Jwaram, Rektapittam, or Rajayakshma, Ruvada Vyadhi. We have to go through the fundamental principles of Ayurveda, or the fundamental components of understanding health and disease as explained by the Acharyas, and then put them into our context of autism spectrum disorder. So we refined it many a times, and still it is in the process of refining, because ultimately the parents bring the, their children to our facility seeking a cure for autism, not just a management, which is quite understandable. Because getting a child with the autism spectrum disorder is obviously quite a devastating experience for any parent. And when they look around and when they see that there could be an option for a treatment and a cure, they forget everything else. They forget about the inconveniences, the expenditure factor, everything, and they come. That is what is happening. That is what we are seeing in the last 19 years. But even today, I would say that treating ASD is not at all an easy thing. It is the outcome actually is depending upon or dependent upon many factors. Now coming to the present status of Sunetri Protocol of Autism, it revolves obviously around the very, very basic concepts of Ayurveda. We have not taken anything to interpret from outside Ayurveda. These three terms, what I have highlighted here, Agni, Ojas, and Manas. Actually, it is around these three terms that the entire protocol is spinning around. Now, we have taken many things from the concept of Visha, as it is explained in Ayurveda. We have given due consideration, due importance to the concepts of Srodas and Mala. So this is the framework of Sunetri Protocol. And as far as the concept of or the theory of Tridoshas, Vayu Pittam Kapham is concerned, that is actually the strength of Ayurveda, where we can precisely explain, understand, decipher very complex conditions with a certain amount of easiness. And as far as the management of ASD or the evaluation and assessment of ASD is concerned, Tridoshas or the theory of Tridoshas helps in profiling each individual case with precision. Now, coming to these three buzzwords, Agni, Ojas, and Manas, we have to have a close look at these three terms. I'm not going to explain what Agni is or what Ojas is or what Manas is. They are very closely connected principles. Agni, when it is properly functioning in a body where the Srotas, the internal pathways, they are intact, obviously contributes for the perfection, functional enhancement of the principle called Ojas. And when Ojas is Sampannam, Pushtam, Vriddham, that reflects in the internal environment of our body. Actually, Ojas is nothing but the representation of the status of the internal environment of an individual. That is very, very important understanding. And when Agni is functioning properly and Ojas is nourished appropriately, optimally, so that the internal environment is very conducive, then obviously the principle called mind, manas, that is free, or that gets a chance to manifest itself with its full potential. If this situation is not prevailing, however powerful, however brilliant the factor, the principle called manas is, it cannot manifest. It cannot perform according to its capacity, its potential. This is very, very important aspect, which is not directly explained in the classics, but which is very evident when we put all the ideas we get from a proper understanding of the Ayurvedic Shariram together. So actually, we were focusing on these three principles primarily: Agni, Ojas, and Manas. And they form a triangle, a functional triangle. So taking the first three letters, we call it AOM, in short, OM triangle. So there is an OM triangle operating within us, every one of us, the functional status of which is going to be very, very critical as far as our physical and mental strength, health, capacity, status is concerned. Now, coming to the protocol, Sunetri protocol for autism, it has got three phases. Phase 1, 2, and 3. Now I will come, actually, I am explaining this with a, I planned this presentation with an understanding that Dr. Reena Kulkarni will be explaining whatever is required to get an entry into this. Anyway, I am continuing with the same mindset. Coming to the first phase of Sunetri protocol, these are the main things involved: a detailed case taking from the time of marriage of the parents, their history regarding the conception, pregnancy period, delivery, everything till date is taken in detail. And based on the information gathered, we make an Ayurvedic profiling of that child. Our main interest in the preliminary assessments will be the status of Agni, status of Grahani, status of Koshta, and the different types of Vayus functioning within. Secondarily, these four factors will give us a pretty good idea about the status of Srodas, status of Ojas, and the clarity of the Dhadus of the body. And from the presenting issues, we will be making some understanding about how the principle called manas, mind, is working. And in the first phase of the protocol, what we target is to get an entry into the ohm triangle. And obviously, the first and the best and the most sustainable point of entry is Agni into the, as far as the ohm triangle is concerned. Getting an entry into the Ojas without getting an entry into the Agni is difficult. Without getting proper entry into the Agni and Ojas, it is very difficult to get an entry into the Manas. So we follow that way. That is a natural track. And in the first phase, we will be focusing on the correction of Agni and related principles, which I have listed here. And in that part, we start with a diet, a modified diet, and a set of very basic medicines. Very basic medicines, maybe one or sometimes two, minimum medicines. Because as you all know, there are many constraints for giving this Ayurvedic medicines in their classical forms. Many of them are not so palatable, bitter taste, bad smell, many things will be there. But interestingly, the children get adjusted to those tastes and smells very fast. So this will be the first phase. As far as the diet is concerned, our principle that way is to try as traditional as possible in every aspect. Traditional stuffs, then traditional recipes, and traditional way of cooking. And we have very clearly noticed, of course, there may be differences in opinion, there may be controversies, but we have very specifically noticed that the present day issue that the society is facing with the altered proteins in wheat and milk, I mean the gluten and casein, they are creating lots of issues with these kids. So we also restrict this intake of gluten and casein. And we give them a chart. What all things can be taken, what all things can be, should be restricted, how you can modify your diet, how much time you can take, and how much compliance is expected. Actually, we expect 101%, not 99%. So all these things will be counseled in the first phase of the first sitting itself. And we prescribe the medicines. They can go back the same day. It is a home-based program, which may last for maybe some 90 days maximum, within which they have to comply with the diet to 100%, start the medicines properly. And we will be giving specific advices about the medicines which they may be already on. So everything should be perfect in that first phase 90 days period. That is what we are taking as some sort of a graduation mark to take the child to the second phase. In the second phase, it is an admission. Actually, we admit the children, the child with his or her parents in Sunetri Ayurveda Ashram. And this admission may go up to 3 weeks. We try to limit the admission for 2 weeks maximum, but sometimes depending upon the case and also the time taken to bring the child to the track of the treatments, it may go up to 3 weeks. And we will be doing some basic therapies again. Here, our intention is to make whatever we have achieved in the first phase enhanced to the next level, and also make sure that the channels, the pathways inside the srodas are functioning in a better manner. The dhadus are pure, clear, unpolluted. Ojas is upgraded to the next level, and making sure that the child is getting a better body consciousness. These are the main therapies what we use. Of course, this list is not complete. The list is quite exhaustive, which I have not brought here. The most important ones may be Vasti, Abhyangam, Shirodhara, Potali Svedam. Sometimes we will be using Potali Svedam with no medicine inside, just Vastra, cloth pieces. Sometimes some Churna. Then sometimes Shashtika Pinda Svedam. And obviously we will be using certain techniques like certain eye drops, then fumigations, dhupanam in the room. Then sometimes we will be giving karna puranam, ear medicines. So such fine tuning will be done according to the individual merit. But mainly these are the therapies, but please do not think that we will be giving all these five listed therapies, and this will be the, don't think that this will be the order of the procedures. I have just loosely listed out the procedures, that's all. So after completion of this second phase, we discharge the child with another prescription. Of course, the diet will be continued, and this new prescription upgrades the child to the third phase. Again, this is a home-based program. It takes sometimes 80 days in most of the cases. Sometimes slight changes may be there, like maybe reduced to half, like 40 days, or maybe enhanced to maybe 120 days, like that. Here, Medhya Rasayanas are used extensively. My time is over.
I think you can take another 5 minutes, sir, and wind up.
Fine, no problem. So Swarnam will be used extensively. Gold preparations will be used along with other medicines, like medicated ghee, kashayam, certain pills, everything. Now, coming to the observations, in the first phase, we observe the digestive issues start settling down. The digestive issues mainly reflected by the eating habits, burps, the chewing, bowels, undigested food particles in the stool, the stinky smelling, all these things. Sleep will be better, and the response to the call also will be better. By the end of the second phase, we expect or we observe better social connectivity, better attention span, the hyperactivity. In most of the cases, by the end of the first phase itself, the hyperactivity will settle down, and communication also will be better. And in the third phase, the language part will be improving, communication will be better to the next level, and the responsiveness as a social being also will improve. So this is what we see in our experience. Still, I say it is highly subjective. The outcome cannot be generalized to 100% of the cases. And as far as Supra is concerned, we can add on all other training programs and trainings, therapies like speech therapy, occupational therapy, all these things which are actually complementary to our program, even though it is not a part of the program. And the special observations about our protocol, it is not very good in its performance with the poor diet complaints. Along with the psychiatric medicines, this protocol is not excellent. Also, when we use multiple types of systems together, say maybe some sort of a polypharmacy, we generally do not advocate. Parent counseling is very, very important. Family support should be perfect, and regular follow-ups are also compulsory. The scope and advantage of this protocol is it can be practiced in all settings, and the results are reasonably good. And overall, the program is not very expensive. And as far as the limitations are concerned, the dietary part is really, really compulsory, and you require a stay in Ayurveda ashram, maybe 2 to 3 weeks, every year, maybe for 3 or 4 years sometimes. That all depends on the gravity of the issue. Yeah, these are a couple of photographs. Child getting his Abhyangam treatment. This is a Shastiga Pindasvedam. It's a photograph of a Shirodhara, nothing more. With that, I conclude. Thank you very much once again for giving me this opportunity. I hope if there are a few questions, we will see it later. Thank you. Especially thank you, Dr. Suhas Shetty. Namaste.
Thank you very much. I think it was very well put forward by you on how you have adopted the basic concepts of Ayurveda and how we have brought the treating aspects of the basic concepts into practice in the management of autism. We'll take up the questions at the end of the session, sir. Kindly be connected with us. Now, we would like to request Dr. Reena Kulkarni to kindly put forward her thought on the topic, the basic understanding of Ayurveda. I kindly request Dr. Reena to kindly keep her talk short, as we are running out of time. Maybe she can take 10 to 15 minutes and maybe briefly and crisply present her topic on Ayurvedic understanding. Over to you, madam.
Oh, so sir, am I audible now?
Yes, madam, you're audible. You can start.
PPT is also visible?
Yes, madam. Please continue. Keep it short for 10-15 minutes, madam.
Sure, sir.
Yeah.
And extremely sorry for that difficulty which happened in between. So, thank you, Dr. Prasad, sir, who has given a nice concept and the protocol which is followed in Sunetri. And now continuing, we were discussing regarding the 4 important aspects, that is Vadivega Samudrama, Samuttana Vishesha, Vikara Prakriti, and Adhishtana. Adhishtana, as it is said, psych or the sattva or the manas is more involved than the body, except for the behavioral component, because more or less physical development remains unaffected. The higher mental faculty is, as sir was telling, are mainly involved, so which are mainly governed by factors like pranavata, udanavata, sadaka pitta, and tarpaka kapha. And of course, the agni, sir was telling agni and rasa is also very important. We'll just discuss this little later. Then when we look into all the 9 categorical considerations of clinical features of autism, which could be grouped under the 8 faculties which are affected with regards to a specific disease described in Ayurveda called as Unmadam. So it is described as Unmadam Punaha Mano Buddhi Sangna Gnana Smruti Bhakti Shila Cheshta Achara Vibramam Vidyata. And now if we consider the faculties affected in autism, see the faculties with regards to the mano vyapara is also affected. Buddhi, the cognition and the intellectual activities are also affected. Then the knowledge about the self and the surrounding is also affected. Sometimes the child can have unusual memory, or sometimes the child is suffering from not at all connected with the things, the attachment. Child can present with unusual attachments with inanimate objects, or a particular set of patterns is seen in case of Unmada. Similarly, Sheila is, these children can present with the typical habits, repetitive repertoires, the behaviors, echolalia kind of things, which all could be grouped under the bhakti. And Sheila, that is the habit, and Chesta, even the fidgeting, the flapping, and hyperactivity, these can be studied under Chesta. Achara, the conduct and behavior, again, without having a specific discriminative power, the child would be wandering. So these faculties can be studied under the 8 important factors of Unmada. So considering this, this particular disease could be viewed as a part of Unmada, and considering the whatever the basic aspects we described. So let us go into Samprapti Vigatana. Uttanada Dosha, as we described, very early the brain is affected, and hence the child can have vitiation with all the 3 doshas. The doshas could be rasa and variable as per the etiology. If the child is having perinatal insults, there could be involvement of brain. In the same way, if the child is having genetic and even the involvement of other issues can also be seen. If the child is presenting heavy metals and the radiation packs and all, so the effect of those also should be considered under the various involvement of those as well as srotas. And majority it is the manovah and the rasavah srotas are affected. Then adhishthana becomes manas and hrudaya. Roga marga is madhyama, and to some extent even prana and we consider it as madhyama roga marga, and antidosha are also involved. Rakthasthana, coming to the book, the manovapara chesta, the rupa is in the form of manadhi, chesta, shila, achara, sangna, gnana, smriti, bhakti, and sometimes it can also be associated with apasmara. Moving on to the principles of management, inevitably, since the rasas are involved, and getting into manas, as sir was telling, and ojas, it is very important to correct the agni and rasa. So mainstay of treatment is always agni chikitsa in the initial stage. Once a level of results are attained, then we can start with either shamana chikitsa or panchakarma based on the need of the child and its presentations. Medha rasayanas, as sir was mentioning, medha rasayanas are the mainstay of treatment. So majority gruta preparations are used, and some of the arishtam based preparations are also used, and along with the other medications based upon needs. So for example, initially we may go to use the agni dipana dravyas, and following which, if the child is presenting with specific features with regards to either taste, smell, or the hearing, then we alter little bit of others. Short and minor procedures would also be incorporated, and the treatment would be planned along with the internal use of medicines. Then sangna prabodhana is also very important as a part of treatment. So we use this minor procedures. Sometimes they may include a nasya. They may include Karanapurna or Karana Abhyanga, Pada Abhyanga, Shiro Abhyanga kind of things. Then Abhyasa. Abhyasa is nothing but, because these children have a less imitations and discrimination, they may not learn their own. So we may have to train. So this training is in the form of Abhyasa. Now moving on to the treatment principles. Since the Tridoshas are involved. And comparing with the levels of the Agni, so whether such a chikitsa have to be considered, chikitsa whether it is in a increased avastha or so you have to balance this. That's the vyatyasa chikitsa. Unmada chikitsa is, of course, is the mainstay of the treatment, and avastika chikitsa based on the dosha, then sthanika chikitsa. For Agni chikitsa, lagu ahara is initially we allow the child. So as sir was telling, many of researchers say that certain kind of food is going to trigger and change the bacterial flora of the gut, and they may start with the presenting typical features, hyperactivity, loss of sleep, the behavioral issues. So that has to be addressed first. So considering that lagu ahara, avoidance of certain foods, then correction using drugs like srajanadi, kalakavale churna, sarsvata churna, asava, vidanga arisha, and ayopayam kashaya, we normally use. Some do even add takrarishtas or based medications to the child also. Followed by rutushana, in case of full-blown features, when bahudosha avastha, we can go for shodhana. So that may say we have an experience like a child comes to the aggressiveness of hyperactivity. If we give them in the little increased quantity, then we see that they go into very calm mind. Then the hyperactivity comes under control. Then the vamana offered by sarjana krama, that is tarpanadi kriya we use. Then sometimes we do give virtana. Normally we use savipatikara churna in our clinic to do virtana. So sometimes a tripleha could also be a better choice. Then of course vasti, if we cannot give rena, we convert it into medhya vastis. Tikshna sangha prabodhana, for that we use nasya, could be in the form of nasya, like, you know, vachna chura, rakna chura, katva chura. Sometimes we use lashuna swarata. Then shamana and rasayana is based on the selection of the medications. Most commonly used medications across India in treatment of autism are like a Brahmi Rasa, Brahmi Kashaya, Kanaka Kashaya. So with the, it is an individualistic plan. We may not generalize these things in Ayurveda, because as I was mentioning, we have to consider a lot of things like Prithi, Agni, compatibility with the medications, then the sensory issues that the child is having, that will outweigh the things and can select. So sometimes, you know, it may not be the perfect protocol which you always follow, but more or less the principles would be the same. Then Gruta Yogas, because we say that Manas is affected, and we all know that to read the mental faculty, the Gruta is the best medium. So in the post Kalakruta, very much aggressive, and we may go to Gruta also. If it is more, then we may go Tikshna Grutas like that, Panchagavya Gruta. Then Sarasvata Rishta, Vidanga Rishta, Ashwagandha Rishtas can also be used. Swarna Prashna Yogas are frequently used. Once certain proper Agni, a child starts responding, then we may start with Swarna Prashna Yogas. And Brahmavati Chintamani in little hyperactive predominant children, we use Brahmavati Chintamani. Kumara Kalyanaka Rasa is excellent because it do contain some elements which are in case of these children, and it is a very good supplement for that. then Jati Faladik Shirapaka sometimes, no, those presenting with a loss of sleep, sleep issues, or the nighttime wandering and all. So the, we can use this kind of things. And Ashwagandha Kshiraka, as we have used to I mean, address these specific symptoms in case of then moving on to standard, sir, Murdhani Tala is the one, because the site of Manas, if we consider, so it is Ashuras and Rudhya we have to consider, then Murdhani Tala remains to be the best. So most probably we use Chandanadi Tala, Hagar or Vatashini. Sometimes even for this either Bala Panchagra or Swami will be using. And then predominant languages we use in procedures like Utsadhana. When we train the mother, a child will be very sensitive. It may not allow the others. It becomes, you know, involved. Management of autism. Then in case of auditory issues, we may ask them to do Padabhyam Karana Purana or Karana then of Chikitsan using earphones. This fidgeting and all things like Bandhana. We may ask the weight of child's leg, ask them to restrain them. In sleep problems, again, you know, Shirodhara and Pada Benga Trataka, rocking, the commonly adopt these kind of procedures. Single drugs which we use in treatment of autism. So you can have Andukappa Brahmi or the important things to address the, as they are the best. And the research, recent research says that Mandukaparni is stimulating the it has
I think we have lost connection with Dr. Reena. She'll be joining us shortly. I think before we move on to the next presentation, we have two more very interesting presentation. May I now request Dr. Pavan Kumar Sharma, sir, to kindly just enlighten us with the upcoming webinars.
Thank you, Professor Suhas. Tomorrow, enjoying jogging, so that will be related with lifestyle disorders. There, from Pakistan, Professor Dr. Iqbal Chaudhary, Dr. On 21st, world is celebrating Yoga Day, Music Day, and we are celebrating Father's Day. So Dr. Ram Manohar, Dr. Bargerle, Dr. Narsingha Murthy, and a grand event we have planned. Your all persons' blessings are required there on 22nd June. It's the program of its unique kind, music therapy, the forgotten episode of the treatment. Vaidya Rajesh Kotechaji, Padma Sri Vaidya Rajesh Kotechaji will be going to inaugurate it. Dr. Arpan Bhatt, Dr. Milan Vasavala, Dr. Kedar Upadhyay, Dr. Sajita Varman, Dr. Sashwin from Philippines, Netherlands, Akash Thakkar from Bengaluru, Dr. Sri Vatsa, Dr. Anant Kumar, all are Ayurvedic experts having expertise in music therapy. Then the trust organized by Pandit Sashank Katti, he is the founder of Sor Sanjeevan Music Therapy Trust. It will be a grand event. And then allopathic doctors also have specialty in music therapy. So Dr. Rahul Bansal, medical college professor, and Dr. Kamalkant Goyal, physician, and this will be participated by national and international dignitaries. So please make it convenient to attend this event. Don't forget to attend this event and bless us with your valuable presence. Thank you. Thank you very much. Dr. Suhas Shettiji. Dr. Suhas Shettiji.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very, very much for informing us about the very interesting upcoming webinars. And I'm sure all of us will join and make this event a grand success. So now we move on to the third presentation by Dr. N.P. Karthikeyan, a renowned ENT surgeon and founder of DOAST Therapy Center for Autism, Chennai. Basically, mainstream trained doctor, but fascinated by the treasure of traditional Indian medical science, he started DOAST, which stands for Doctor-Oriented Art of Symbiotic Treatment, the Center for Integrated Therapy. At DOAST, he is striving to usher in a new era of integrated therapy by fusing these time-tested methods of ancient healing with the innovations of modern medicine. With a focus on management of these gray areas by identification of new treatment windows and appropriate, safe, and cost-effective medications and therapies from the traditional Indian medical system. He specialized in the treatment of cancer, acute and chronic respiratory ailments, and especially autism. I'm very happy to welcome Dr. N.P. Karthikeyan. Dr. Karthikeyan will be talking about the topic Bubble to Independence through DOAST Integrated Therapy. May I now kindly request Dr. Karthikeyan to kindly present his presentation. May I request Dr. Pawan sir to kindly put the slides. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much. Om Ishwaraya Namaha. I thank the Lord Shiva for giving me the opportunity and directing me to present my hands-on experience to this august audience. I pray to him that this presentation brings in lots of this eminent group, which brings in a lot of benefits to the autistic community and the parents as well. I initially tell you, or I apologize, I'm going to be a little different from the presentations that you have seen earlier, because this concept is integration or symbiotic therapy. And this is born out of a lot of lateral thinking, not consistently adhering to the norms of the literature. It might deviate from the literature, it might deviate from the normal procedures adopted by authentic people. But all this lateral thinking and imaginative hypothesis are aimed at bringing benefit to the children with autism. So with this small introduction, I want to introduce my center, which is called the DOAST Integrated Therapy Center for Autism. DOAST means Doctrine-Oriented Art of Symbiotic Treatment, meaning that we are addressing the gray areas in medicine. Even though the technology has grown very well, we still have many gray areas in medicine where there is no definitive treatment provided by the mainstream modern medicine. Autism falls into one such category. Working from 1987 to 2000, 3 with a lot of Siddha physicians and then lateral thinking people gave me a lot of confidence that the traditional Indian medical system is a gold mine of knowledge, which is being underutilized due to very many reasons. Maybe several things were lost in the transit of history through many occupations. So I concentrated on the herbals, which can give regeneration. And then I went into biotechnological analysis of herbs to identify the molecular mechanisms and identify the active molecule, and then see whether the active molecule could be brought into the medicine without any damage. Those experiences gave me a lot of confidence, and then I wanted to start a treatment center. I wanted to abolish the term of alternate therapy, because I thought all the traditional Indian systems called alternative therapy are not alternative therapy. They are much, much evolved systems. And the mainstream medicine is an evolving system out of this traditional medical sciences. So that is why I coined the term integrated therapy. And it is not something new. CAM was existing in USA, complementary alternate medical system, coming into US. And then it was trying to treat people with malignancies, stage 3 and stage 4 mammary cancers and all that. And I took autism that was falling into no man's land. Neither the neurologist cared with. The title which I had given, Bubble to Independence, may look a little poetic now, but it is my mission statement. You know, autistic children are inside a bubble. My mission statement, or my ambition then, was to bring these children out of the bubble into independence. Way back in 2001 to 2002, the aim was to make them include into the society. I set a higher goal. I set a goal of independence because my heart was beating towards the parents. When the children do not become independent, the parents suffer a lot and the family suffers a lot. I want all you people to think that autism is one condition where the patient does not suffer. It is the parents who suffer. And the parents suffer, and then they don't sleep. When they go to sleep, they think, what will happen to their child after us? Those things made me set my goal that by the age of 18, we would make autistic children independent, at least semi-independent, so that the parents are at ease. All these things, 18 years back, 2003, it was all bold statements, or some people consider that as an idiotic statements or statement of madness, because autism was at an intersection of contradictions. Still, it was an intersection of contradictions. Multiple systems gridlock. It is a gridlock between the neurological system, immune system, digestive system, and psychiatry. It progressed from 1960 to 1980 as a psychiatric condition. And after that, people started working about organic ailments. And then it underwent a lot of stages. And only piecemeal approaches were applied to the treatment. Nobody called it treatment. They called it training. And it was almost like blind man seeing elephant story. And to top it all, the US medical research announced that it is hardwired and it cannot be rewired. In this kind of scenario, we launched integrated therapy, saying like we would make the children from the bubble to independent existence. The reason why I made that statement was I made a lot of retrospective study. As I told you, from the time it was announced, somewhere in 1940s to 1960, it was under the clutches of the psychiatric profession. And you must be heard, I mean, you must have heard about refrigerated mothers. It was said like mothers with a freezer-like uterus gave birth to frozen children. And then after that, somebody took up organic theory after the ASA, the Autism Society of America, was born. Dr. Rimland paved way for bringing it out of the clutches of the psychiatric entity into an organic entity. Many endoscopies were done, and the theory up to 1980 to 1990, it said like these children have silent pain in their intestines, and that pain is the manifestation of all their agitative behavior. Then around 2004, Dr. Zimmerman in Kennedy Krieger Institute came out with a finding that these brains have inflammation. They have cytokines very active in their brains, especially the cerebellum and the Purkinje fibers area, and also in the somatosensory cortex. So I connected all these dots. First of all, I didn't consider it as a psychiatric manifestation. I took it up as an organic condition, and I connected the dots saying like the primary intestinal inflammation could cause a secondary inflammation in the brain, resulting in a particular statement was a hypothesis. It was the pathophysiology. So it was totally different from the symptomatic approach people took then to a biological approach. When people looked at, treating the branches, I went about treating the root so that the branches would correct themselves. Let me have the second slide, please. I told you I generated my own hypothesis for the whole thing. I want you to look at this flow chart. If you look at the yellow squares, that is all of us, the so-called neurotypical normal people, we have a normal performance because we have our genes, which are in quite a good order. We have a robust molecular structure. We have a nice protein expression by the genes. We have nice neurotransmitters and neuronal connectivity, and which results in a complete coherence in our brains. This is controlled by the immune system. The immune system consists of the CNS, central nervous system, endocrine system, and the gastroenterological system. And all this is connected by a biofeedback and autonomic balance. This, if it is expressed in another way, it can be said as BPK balance, which is connected to the atmosphere, and we all function as antennas. I'll tell you, take it in a very, very light manner. If I give 2 pigs of alcohol to my moderator and ask him to come and moderate the session, I introduce a stressor into a system, his biological feedback will be affected, and he will behave in an altered way because his network works in an altered hemostasis. He will show symptoms pertaining to autism. He may be agitated. He will say, "Kathy, cut it down." He will put the mic off and all these things. And that is how I looked at autistic children. They were born with not a robust molecular structure. They had a susceptible genetic landscape. That those times people were talking about single gene affected, multiple genes affected, and all this kind of thing. I had a different theory. It is a susceptible genetic landscape. They were vulnerable to the environmental toxins, which you and I were not affected because we had a very robust molecular structure. So these environmental toxins affected their downstream systems. By downstream systems, I mean the gastrointestinal system, which is exposed every day 24/7 to outside influence. So when this downstream system is inflamed, it creates cytokines. Those cytokines get into the bloodstream. They break what is known as the brain blood-brain barrier, and then they get into the brain and they cause inflammation of the neuroglia. And then when there is an inflammation of the neuroglia, there is a connectivity problem, and the connectivity problem results in a behavioral bouquet, which is called autism. Is that clear? So this is my pathophysiological hypothesis for autism. Next slide, please. So I told you my whole concern was parents. Parents are not interested in listening to our hypothesis. There are gigabytes of data which are available in the internet about the autism. They are bothered about what kind of benefit you can give to my child, whether you can make my child independent. That is the question. So it is not enough for me to form a pathophysiological hypothesis. I have to create a treatment hypothesis which will match the pathophysiological hypothesis, or otherwise that can be called a treatment window. The integrated therapy is the treatment window that I created. And the integrated therapy was born out of my almost 15 years of experimentation or collection of data from various quarters of people who practice traditional medical systems. In integrated therapy, the process in the diet, we said no milk, no wheat, no meat. And this was followed very strictly. It is a 100% compliant dietary schedule. And I am extremely thankful for all my parents. With all their difficulties, they followed the dietary protocol. And they followed the dietary protocol because they saw the benefits. And this particular lecture I dedicated to all the parents who cooperated with me and then did all that they can do to strictly follow the dietary therapy. After diet, we used yoga, we used oleation therapies, we used herbal medication. All these things were synergistic, one helped another. So even when the patient gets diagnosed, we tell the parent, your child is diagnosed with autism, we are reconfirming it, and you follow the dietary therapy and come back after a month. The patient comes after a month saying, like, with the dietary therapy, I see a lot of changes in my child, so I come to you. Because my program is rigorous and it is almost lifelong. And the first protocol lasts about 3 months, in which we give the yoga, oleation therapy, and the herbal medications in a big way under our supervision. And it is a parent included program. The parent is there with the child all the while, and it cooperates. And it is to the credit of all my professionals. These children perform yoga in all the components that the yoga has to be performed: asanas, breathing techniques, and meditation in some children. And we do the oleation therapies. We use naturopathy graduates to do the therapy. And all these are done to alleviate the cellular stresses. People like Dr. Madan Thangavelu and Dr. Sri Kumari in the audience will understand what I mean by cellular stresses. And these stresses are not affecting us, and it is affecting these children. And in this COVID pandemic, you know what kind of stresses we were subjected to. This is different from the ORIs or stress. These are stresses which affect your gene, which affect your gene expression. And by the gene expression, it goes and creates lasting damage to the system. So when I program my integrated therapy and then direct it towards the cellular stressors. The stressors come down and the downstream inflammation is alleviated. So downstream systems, that is the gastrointestinal system and also associated endocrine system, become much, much better. The cytokine production is reduced and the damage to the blood-brain barrier is reduced. And there is a restoration in the network homeostasis. And when the network is getting restored, there is an improved behavior and cognition. And that improved behavior and cognition, we have set a timeline to it. We tell the patient, within this kind of time frame, your child would start looking at you, and the child will have better sleep, and the child would have better coordination in the activity. And the best of all, we predict the child would have better empathy. And when there is a better empathy which is setting in, we get better language acquisition. And to the pride of integrated therapy, I have to make a statement here. We do not give occupational therapy or speech therapy for these children, because we consider anything which is not biological is not therapy. They are only interventions. It is occupational intervention and speech intervention. When the speech mechanism is not coherent, the child cannot speak. We take pride in our integrated therapy that it will make the speech mechanism coherent. And when it becomes coherent, our children begin to speak. They begin to acquire words every day, spontaneous. And they speak more languages than one. They just don't stop with one, and they speak 2-3 languages. And there is a tonal clarity in the speech, which is unknown in autistic world. Next slide, please. Next slide, sir. So what I showed you in a flowchart manner, I put it in arrows here. So the inflammation, the chronic inflammation, is my common denominator. When people said every autistic child is different, we have to program different. I used to ask them, if we have million children, do we have million programs? It is not practically possible. And it is not practically possible for the parent to follow that. So my denominator is inflammation. I would reduce the inflammation, improve the coherence of the brain. I am not targeting the brain. I am targeting the gastrointestinal system. And I restore the molecular order in the gastrointestinal system, and I follow it up with physiological markers. When most of the children who come to us, they come with constipation to obstipation. The first benefit that the children, that the parents say is like, he is eating a little better and he is passing his stools without smell. And we ask them to watch the stools every day. That's a physiological marker of internal restoration. And once that becomes better, the sleep becomes better. When the sleep becomes better, their daytime behavior becomes better. They become much more cooperative in the treatment protocols. And the restored molecular order such way improves behavior and cognition. And I have to say, in between the behavior and cognition, there is an improved empathy. You must be knowing, people said these children are born without mirror neurons. We challenged them. We said, like, they are all born with mirror neurons. All their neurons are clouded with inflammation. And when the cloud of inflammation goes away, they get connected. And it happens in most of our children. And almost all of us children exhibit empathy. And we have devised a scale for empathy also. And when we replicated this results, it gives credit to my theory that chronic inflammation is the common denominator. So with which we proceeded, and constant replication now is, you know, forcing me to get into epigenetic expression patterns and genetic expression patterns by which we can measure it in a much better way to present it to the mainstream world that this is a very ideal treatment protocol for autism. Next slide. Next slide, sir. So this is the proof of the pudding where you can see the independence of this child.
He is autistic. We were really heartbroken. He has been attending dosed for about 2 months. And within these 60 days, he is coming up really well. And I can see he can follow small instruction. And he's coming up with few words now. And he is really calm now. He's not as before. And he is really doing well in classes and everything. And it gave us a really good time, yeah, and which we didn't expect real soon.
The same boy in 2019.
விக்னேஷ் இங்கிலீஷ்ல பேசுவான் அப்படின்னு தெரியும்.
ரெக்கார்டிங் தானே கேட்கிறாங்க.
நீங்க செய்வீங்களா? ஆனந்தி தலை உட்காருங்க.
Next slide, please. So this is one of those children in whom we have achieved independence. I sincerely thank such parents because most of the parents do not wish that their child's video is shown. And this is the only evidence as of now, till we have genomic expression patterns as a proof of their improvement. And he is working in Sydney, Australia as an electrician. And then he is shaping up very well. Recently, last month, he phoned up to say how I am doing in corona pandemic. So that is the kind of, you know, pride that I get, which completely erases all the obstacles and the, you know, brickbats even my colleagues throw at me. Now, I want to conclude by saying we have not got an assured response to every crisis in this world. And let us not dishearten by saying like autism, there is no assured response. Good enough, perfection, aiming for perfection is the enemy of good enough. let us use what is good enough and then do better to these children. And we have to remember that science is a relay race and it is not a 100-meter sprint. I'm comparing the 100-meter sprint and the relay race because science, and actually medical science, is practiced as 100-meter sprint, where everybody claims that I am the greatest. It is not so. It has to be a relay race. We have to pass the baton to others. COVID has proven that 100-meter sprint will not help anymore. We are seeing the acute phase of COVID. We are yet to see the chronic phase of COVID, where we have to do a lot of integration in our sciences and then help the humanity. I conclude and thank everyone. And again, I repeat my prayers that this presentation to all of you should kindle a lot of thoughts in you and then bring in a lot of improvement by a symbiotic work together, which will give benefit to the children with autism all over the world. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for enlightening us on the basic approach that you have taken in the management of autistic disorders. I think, as rightly mentioned by Dr. Madan Thangivelu in the chat box, that best is the enemy of better. I think it's very important that we understand what is normal for these children and go ahead with this intention. So now we move on to the next presentation, the last presentation of the day. May I now introduce to the August audience, Dr. C.M.M. Raju, Professor in the Head, Department of Komarabhrutya, Government Ayurveda Medical College, Bengaluru. He's a very passionate teacher and a clinician with over 18 years of experience in the field of the pediatric care. He has contributed various original articles and has been a part of various research projects. Recently, he was also a part of the home quarantine enforcement squad in COVID-19 from the Department of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Now, may I kindly request Dr. C.M.M. Raju to talk on the specialized therapy and the role of diet in autism. Over to you, Dr. Raju. I think you're muted, Dr. Raju. You need to unmute yourself.
Please unmute yourself. You are muted. Yes.
You are still not audible, Doctor. Yeah. Hello. Dr. Raju, are you able to hear me? You're not audible, Dr. Raju. Hello?
Is there any problem, Dr. Raju?
Your voice is not audible, Dr. Raju. Dr. Raju could join us, I have a few questions which has been put forward by the audience. My first question would be to Dr. M. Prasad, sir. I think Dr. Sahana Shankari would like to know what are the various Basti Dravyas that are beneficial in the management of autism as per your experience. If Dr. Prasad is there with us.
Dr. Suhas, can you just repeat the question? I was not hearing it properly. Sorry.
Yes. What is the relevance of the Basti Dravyas in the management of autistic disorders? Or how do we select the Basti Dravyas in the management of autistic disorders?
Okay, fine. See, actually, in the beginning, we were trying conventional Basti Dravyas only. Like technically speaking, with the Madhu Tailika type of Dravyas, simply because our target was just to have Vadanulomyam. And that Vadanulomyam, especially the Anuloma of Apanavayu, was giving very good influence on the working status of all other Vayus. So initially, we were working with the basic Vastis. But later, we experimented with many other Vasti Dravas, which can directly influence the status of environment in the entire koshtam, especially the status of Agni, and also something which can assist the Agni to its Vishahara property. Agni is an excellent power which can throw away the Visha in the point of entry itself, even though it cannot digest it. So now we are trying many things. For example, we have tried Takravasti, we have tried Mastu Vasti, we have tried Dadhi Vasti, we are trying many types of Kashaya Vastis, which are not in its classical format. That means not all the ingredients of a classical Kashaya Vasti will not be there, but Kashayam and Kalkam alone. Many things we are trying according to the special case. For example, we will be giving Kalyanagam Kashayam with Vilvadi Guliga sometimes, Kalyanagam Kashayam with the Shadharana Churnam as a Kalkam. Similarly, many other Kashayam which are having specific interest in this particular case, we are trying, we are exploring the our maximum possible areas in the Vasti Chikitsa.
Thank you very much for throwing a light on your experience on Basti Dravyas in autism. If Dr. Raju is ready, I think we could further proceed with the presentation. Dr. Raju, are you ready from your side? Hello? We are not able to hear your voice, Dr. Raju. Your video is visible, I think, but we are not able to get your voice. So I think if by the time Dr. Raju joins, we have one more question. May I ask Dr. Reena Kulkarni if she is present here? We have heard about the different protocols in today's session by Dr. Prasad on the Sunetri protocol and Dr. Karthikeyan talking about the Dost protocol. I'm also learned that you also have a specific protocol called as Sambhodhi protocol. If you could throw some light on this, Dr. Reena, on the Sambhodhi protocol that you follow for the management of autism. Dr. Reena?
Yes, sir. Yes. Sambhodhi protocol is one. Of course, it is still in the stage of evolution because many people have already mentioned that there is no strict protocol for each day, but we go with a principle. So in Sambodhi protocol, what we do is, as soon as the child visits our OPD at the STM Institute of Ayurveda, what we do is we just have an evaluation of these children. And of course, we do use certain of the evaluation protocols, like, you know, MCHAT, ESA and all, only to evaluate the children. Once we know them, we do take their detailed history, and then we do note their physiological aspects, including their Agni, the status of their Koshta, the status of their sleep, status of their behavior with people and family members and other kids. So these things, we initially note these factors. And the first protocol in Sambodhi is definitely Agni Chikitsa. What we do is, for 2 to 3 weeks, we advise the parents based on, sometimes what happens, you know, children comes with different issues. A child may come with constipation. A child may come with frequent loose stools. Child may come with frequent pain abdomen. Child may come with sleep issues. So based on their need, we set the Agni correction drug. It may be like Rajanyadi Churna, or it may be like Hinguashtaka Churna, or sometimes we select Vilvadi Gutika, or you know, Dushi Vishari Agada we select. So that will, this protocol will go for about 2 to 3 weeks. And along with this, we advise mother to undergo certain procedures, I mean, do certain procedures to the child, which may include gentle samvahana therapy, that is the squeeze massage to the child, and something like padabhyanga, something like shiro abhyanga, we ask them to do along with this agni dipana chikitsa. Once the child starts having a proper, you know, normally, as sir was also telling, Karthikeyan sir, these parents will come back with the statement that the child is eating well, the child is looking at our eyes, the child is responding to us. So these are the initial comments which we get from the parents. Then from them, and then they said to have a regular patterns with their eating habits and bowel habits. After that, we normally starts with other treatment. So that
Dr. Reena, if you can just summarize, and we can take up with Dr. Raju.
Then the other treatments, sure, sir. Like Abhyanga, Shirodhara, Vasti and all will be selected. And the whole protocol of this treatment, you know, like initially 2 to 3 weeks of Agni Chikitsa. Then in every month, we call these children with the parents for 10 days for set protocol of treatment. So we normally say a few children who give excellent results in about 2 to 3 months, but few would take about a year to respond to us. It varies with the child, so that variations we are seeing. And in between, we select as per the need. Vasti we may select, we may select Virechana. That depends as per the need of the child.
Thank you very much. Now may I kindly request Dr. Raju to start his presentation on. Dr. Raju will be talking about the specialized therapies and diet in autism.
Is
yeah, you can make it voice, full slide.
My voice is audible.
Yeah, your voice is audible. You can make this slides full screen. Yeah, I think it's fine. You can go ahead, Raju.
Okay, I'll explain very briefly. So thanks for Pawan Kumar sir and my dear friend Dr. Suhas. So specialized therapies, diet in autism. Sir. So treatment principles, we can plan on the patients. Shamanam, Shodhanam, Dhidhairya, Atmadhi, Vijnanam, and Upakrama, supportive treatments as external applications. So So modern interventions is also helpful for the treating the autism patients. So some of the, it is a supportive treatment, that is occupational therapy, speech therapy, applied behavioral therapy, social skill class, therapeutic horseback riding, and picture exchange communication system. All this helpful for the improvement in the signs and symptoms. There is a currently no one standard treatment for ASD, but there are many ways to help minimize the symptoms and maximize abilities is very important. The most effective therapies and intervention are often different for each person. So some of the treatments are single drugs, combined drugs, as a decoctions, herbal powder, and confectionaries, hot infusions, and tablets. The single drugs we are used, the syncopushpi, olam, shankapushpa moolam along with cooked in bulk given for the 90 days, it is in help in improving eye contact. And the brahmi panchangam along with the butter given for the 80 days. So each and every symptoms is a different from the each children. So we prepare some of the medicines and given for the children for improving the small changes is also very important.
Slight louder, please, Dr. Raju. Slight louder, please.
Okay. Brahmi panchangam along with butter. It is helpful for the reducing the screaming. Vacha moolam. It is using for the internal and external applications also. For 60 days, use along with honey. So improvement in the verbal expressions. Jyotishmati bijam along with water for 50 days. It is a feeling of a left alone. It is when the patient is a feeling left alone, there is a improvement changes in the signs and symptoms. Bilva panchangam along with the boiled water, it is helpful for the metabolic disturbance. It is when are the metabolic disturbance, use bilva the panchangam along with boiled waters, definitely the changes of the metabolic disturbance. One minute. So next we can use decoctions. Decoctions is a drakshadi, they using along with jatamamsa churnam for 50 days. It is helpful for the decreases restlessness. Abhiramooladi along with grutam, it is a reduce the tantrum. So somavalgyadi along with brahmi grutam for the 120 days you are given, they improve in the verbal skills and see the changes in the language abnormalities. Draksha madukari along with grutam, it is reducing the screaming. Pala kanaka patradi along with mahapaisachya grutams for 120 days you are given, and improvement in the eye contact, increase the appetite. The herbal powders, you can call it as a churnas. Say guluchyadi churna along with Saraswati grutam, reduce the restlessness, improvement in the understanding the instructions. And astachurna along with the grutams, reduce the self beating and hand flapping. Vachadi churnam along with unequal quantity of Madhu and Gruta, improvement in communications. Daddy must have come Churna along with Madhu, reduce the gastrointestinal disturbance. Saptamrutam Churna along with Kshira, reduce the excitement. So some of the configurations, it is helpful. Confectioner is helpful. Kushmandu Rasayanam for 90 to 100 days, change in impaired cognitions. Shatavari Gulam for 6 months, improvement in optic speech impairment. And Ashwagandha the Rasayanam for given for the 8 months, reduce the hyperactivity and get good sleep. At odd infusions. So draksha along with Eshtimadhu and Pippali mix with the milk and given for 30 days reduce the tantrum. Chandanam plus Jatamamsi and Palapushpa. So is given with water and cane sugar, changes in the short term memories. Chandanam along with the Jatamamsi, Musta and Shatavari and Vacha. Even for 50 days, so reduce the repeating verbals. Next, tablets. The Manasamitra Vatakam, even for the 6 months along with milk, reducing the gaze towards the single directions. Smuti Sagara Rasam, even for 15 days along with ginger juice and honey, improving the short-term memory and controls internal fits. Mrutyu Sanjeevani Vagutika is along with consuming with milk, improve eye contact and communication skills. Vilvadi Gutika along with ginger juice and honey. That is a in abnormal metabolic reflexes. And Lagu Kadiradi Gutika along with warm waters for 6 months, improvement in better coordination and Mukha Angas. So role of Shodhana, it is difficult and not eligible for the treating in the autism patients. Sometimes you are using Matra Vasti resulted in temporary result of improving eye contact within children with a gastrointestinal disturbance. Tantrum and excitement were found to be aggravated if it is giving a long term for the Matra Vastis. So these are some of the modern therapy is helpful for supporting treatment. So behavioral management therapy, applied behavior analysis, and occupational therapies, prerana, speech therapy, walk pravruti, social skill classes, and picture exchange communication systems, and therapeutic horseback riding. It is helpful in the some focus and behavior in helpful communications and motor skills. And strength and balance also. Some of the upakramas, what we are using so many patients. So upakramas, the abhyanga, taila shirodhara, shiropichu, anna lepam, pratimarsha nasyam. So abhyanga you are using for the kshirabala taila. So maximum you are given for the 10 days along with the matravastis. With Kshirabala Taila, Abhyanga with Kshirabala Taila for the every month 2 times for 10 days. And it is helpful for the reducing the lead quantity content in the body, and it is reduce the hyperactivity. And the Shirodhara, you are using a Brahmi Taila along with the Kshirabala Taila for 10 days in 1 month, and it is given for the 8 months treatments. It is a changes in the daily eye contact, and then afterwards the hyperactivities and disturbance sleep is reduced. Anna lepam, This is also improving for the their motor movements and reduces the their hyperactivities. Pratimarshanasya. You are using Pratimarshanasya with the Panchendriya Vardaka Taila for the continuous treatments. So this is helpful for the speech and the disturbance of sleep is reduced. And Shiropichu you can use for the Tungadrumadi Taila and along with you can use for the Himasagara Taila. But you should not keep for the Shiropichu more than the 10 to 15 minutes. It may be the causes some of the running nose and difficulty to breathe, all this. So Shiropichu is helpful for the reducing the hyperactivities. So diet, I will share you. So say ensure a time chart plus or minus 20 minutes for your kids for the following activities. Ensure your brain sensor to streamline the neuro activities. Walking from bed, bath, toileting, food, exercise, and sleep. Incorporate your child always with your almost all activities of daily living. Be pleasant and charming always with your kid. You are the best doctors and manager of your kid. Your kid. Food is very important and patya and following the food habits is very important for the treating the autism. Try to be vegetarian maximum. Completely avoid shell, fishes and meat. Food and sleep gap should be 1.5 hours. Administrate complete gluten-free and casein-free diet. Wash hands, foot, ears, mouth and face before food with normal water or cold water. Amount of odd should be as per its appetite, not as per nutritive value or affinity towards the food. Eat only warm and fresh food. Avoid too spicy and fried food. Eat and wait in calm and quiet places. Eat with more number of members together. Enhance the use of ash gourd, yogurt should be strictly avoided. The food that has to be consumed without any second thoughts, this you can use. And vegetables and fruits. So here we are, they made it as a simple diet chart. So what should be the breakfast and 11 a.m. and what should be given and lunch and 4 p.m. and dinner. This is definitely, it is a lot of changes in sinus symptoms and they will help for the, if it is any gastrointestinal disturbance, it is also changes. This is helpful for the parents to follow the some of the diet. It is very difficult to explain the parents to follow the this diet. So it is better to give the printed notes. This is we are following for the treating the autism patients. And sleep. Ensure 8 hours of sleep at night. Don't allow your child to sleep at night. Daytime except during a summer and after exhausted day. Fumigate the room before sleep with following drugs. This should not be done in a case of allergic asthma tendency. Vacha, Ingu, Vidanga, Nimbapatra, Aridra, Guggulu. Ensure the sleep not on a floor and yoga. And these are the some of the yogas. It is helpful definitely for the motor movements. And sitting asanas, standing asanas, supine asanas. Bath should be on a regular time. Ensure a minimum of 20 minutes shower. Apply the prescribed oil from a doctor on 8 to 15 minutes before bath. Hot water on body and normal water on head should be ensured. Apply pinch of rasna di churna can be purchased from Ayurveda on a day immediately after birth, after bath. Sorry. So, thank you, Suha sir and Pawan Kumar sir. So, giving
thank
the
you, answer
for autism. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dr. Raju, for sharing your experiences in the management of the autistic child. We have one more question to Dr. Karthikeyan. During your presentation, you focused that the diet prescription. You asked the children to avoid milk. Any specific observation that you have seen, and any specific reason for the children to avoid milk? Though the wheat and meat is, we are understandable, but any specific reason to avoid milk, Dr. Karthikeyan?
Milk is related to the casein, and see, like it is again, as I told you, it is as we do it, kind of an experiment. So. It is a treatment-guided research that we are doing, or a translational study. And our, the parents give us a lot of feedback. There was a question in the chat box about the publication. The fact that we have not gone into publication because we are using many inputs into it. We are using diet, we are using yoga, and all these things. So this becomes very difficult to get into a you know, authentic publication. We really want to do an authentic publication by studying the microbial flora which comes out, and then see whether there is a, and we have proposed, and then we have done many studies, and then we have initiated some studies in identifying the microbial flora, and we are only able to observe the physiological consistency of the stools after the milk. And then supposing we insist on milk. I'll tell you one particular example. A child came from Australia, and there are many children who exist only on milk. There are many autistic children. And then when this child was referred from Australia by a pediatrician there, we told them milk is not to be given. They just threw a tantrum saying like, our child will die without that. I said like, it's okay. Existence is almost equal to death. You just give him fruit juice or whatever. And 3 days gone, and then after that they came, and then now we are not giving milk at all, because what they found was the child got up in the middle of the night, opened the orange juice bottle and then drank it. And then this was not done by the child. It was not taught to him also. Just stopping milk, this happened. And the relative who came there commented, because this fellow went to the bathroom and then came out, and that relative told him, once this boy goes to the toilet, the whole house stinks. How that the stink is not there today? We took away the milk from him. And even till date, they are not given the milk. And then accidentally, and we have observed a fantastic finding in many of these children, they themselves refuse. And that is a, you know, that is a learning for us. And there are many children, we stop them completely from meat, and then when they come to us, they exist only on meat. And after 6 months to 9 months, they themselves say they don't want meat. Because the theory, when the psychiatric theory was ruling the world, it was pronounced that these children do not have self. But these children have self. So we all have self. And they say the autistic children do not have self. So they have eaten and then felt the pain. Now that it is not given to them, they have experienced the experience of not having pain. And when they see the meat, they say like, this will create pain. And then this again, for me, it is a physiological marker of coherence. There are several functional areas which are connected in the brain which says don't eat it. That is a, you know, expression of serotonin. And that is an expression of parasympathetic overflow, where all these children have sympathetic overflow. They go and grab your food and then eat, and then they wait for their chance to eat. So that's what I said, like we work only with physiological markers, which we observe and the parents observe and the relatives observe. We tell the parents, when you take your child to a relative's house, don't tell them that they are taking a treatment. Let them come and tell you, okay, I see a difference in your child. Because once you tell them, I am taking a treatment and I am not giving the milk and wheat and all that, the immediate response from the relatives and the friends is, how will the child live without meat, without milk and all that? You are causing, you are killing the child. But when they say like we see an improvement, then they say like we stop this and then we see the improvement. See, we are living, it is now 18 years and the situation has not changed. It is very difficult for me to announce that the child has autism. They break down, there is an emotional breakdown, and the acceptance is still, the denial is more. And then after 3 months, when we insist on the diet and they see the improvement in a minimal eye contact and all these features, then only the parents start complying with the therapy. And it is again, they have to experience what has happened with our strict regime. And one more thing I didn't tell you, we do not allow electronic gadgets anywhere near the child. We ask the parents to throw away the TV, switch off the Wi-Fi, no cell phones near the child. And it has been proven beyond doubt, the LED screens trigger your EEG patterns. And the child is already inside a bubble. And then TV is a virtual world. And the child goes into the virtual world and they don't come out. They say like, without watching the TV, my child will not eat. I tell them, let the child starve for 3 days. After that, it'll come and eat. That is what happens. See, well, there is a certain amount of medicine, certain amount of physiology, certain amount of jail warden kind of a behavior, everything you have to do. Ultimately, we are aiming at independence. See, people ask me, what is your success rate? I tell them, the child not wearing a diaper is a success for me. The child not coming and then defecating in the middle of the hall is a success. And I cannot put percentage, I cannot put numbers for this. These are all physiological things. And the empathy scaling, the child comes and wipes off the tears from the mother. That is the height of empathy. That is happening in many children. And earlier, the child will not care. The child will look at the parent as a material provider and not parent. And when the empathy comes only, then only many parents, they have come and cried, this is when I know that the child is looking at me as a father or mother. And now I know that I'm only a material provider, I'm not a father or mother. So autism is a world by itself. And, though I have graduated from Western medicine and then into ENT, the ENT gives me enough money to practice integrated therapy so that I get these kind of pleasures, which is unmeasurable. And again, I tell you, like, unless we create biological markers, we cannot create evidence for all these therapies. And I have spoken many a times with Professor Madan about the biological markers and then several other technologies which we can use. That is why I prayed that these kind of meetings brings in brains together measuring through genomic expression patterns, and Professor Madan knows very well. And then these things, again, these meetings are connecting dots, and then let them connect the correct dots, and then all the efforts of Professor Madan and Professor Aman should not go waste, and then they should gather momentum and then connect dots, and then we should work together. And I may sound very pessimistic, I am really scared about the COVID pandemic, because I am scared about the pregnant women during the pandemic. And we have seen a lot of Sri Lankan mothers, and the incidence of autism is very high in the Sri Lankan ethnic community. So COVID pandemic is a very, very stressful atmosphere, and I really pray that this should not multiply the statistics of autistic outcome in children due to the stress, and then there are many things. We can go on and on, but you know, there is a time limit.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your valuable time and being a part of this great initiative, being spearheaded by Dr. Pawan Kumar Sharma, sir. Once again, on behalf of the Independent Research Ethics Society and Zandu Imami and Ayush Foundation, in association with Vishwa Ayurveda Parishad, is very happy to organize such intellectual webinars. And I thank all the speakers and all the participants for their valuable presence. And now, may I kindly request Dr. Pawan Kumar Sharma, sir, for the concluding remarks. Over to you, sir.
I would like to request Dr. Vishnu Prasad Sharma ji for his concluding remarks.
You are muted, sir. Sir, you are muted.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear my voice?
Sir, please go ahead, sir.
Respected Modern Sangha Fellow, respected Dr. Pawan Kumar Sharmaji, respected Dr. Subhash Kumar Shetty, respected invited speaker, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I offer my sincere thanks to all the eminent speakers for their beautiful lecture they have delivered. The first, Dr. Reena Kulkarni. She nicely described details about the disease and principle of management. She gives stress, use of Kumar Kalyan Rasa is very good and Noisya is also very effective. Thank you, Reena Kulkarni, for your nice presentation. Next, Vaidya M. Prasad. He has presented Sunetary Protocol for Autism. He has given stress to maintain the Agni. If we keep our Agni perfect, then we'll be free from lots of diseases. Again, he has given stress on diet. Diet should be traditional recipe and traditional cooking and medicine along with posti therapy, oibhanga, chirodhara, potoli swedanam, sastik, chali pindar swedam, medha, prayog, gold preparation medicine, speech therapy, and parents' council is very important according to him. So thank you, Buddha M. Prasad, for your excellent deliberation of your speech. Next, I would like to offer my sincere thanks to Dr. N.P. Karthe K. Kiran. Thank you, sir, for your excellent presentation. He has presented the hypothesis very nicely. He has given stress regarding gastrointestinal disturbance, no milk, no wheat, and give stress on the diet, yoga, oleation therapy, herbal treatment. Thank you, sir, for your excellent presentation. Next, Dr. M.M. Raju. He has delivered lecture on specialized therapy and diet in autism. He has given stress on Langana and purification and use of single herbs, mostly Shankhapushpi, Brahmi, Jyotishmati, Bilbadi, Panchang, and decoction, Dakha, and herbal, some herbal powder preparation also. And he asked to use syrup issue. And he has given stress to consume vegetarian diet only, So thank you, Dr. M.M. Raju, for your beautiful presentation. Next, I offer my sincere thanks to Pavan Kumar Sharmaji and moderator Suhas Kumar Shetty for nicely conduct the webinar. Next, thanks to all the delegates and all the distinguished guests who has attended the webinar. Thank you. Namaskar to all.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor Madan Thangvelu ji. Thank you, Dr. Karthikeyan ji. Thank you, Suhas Shetty ji. Thank you, Jayesh Thakkar ji. Sabhi ko bahut bahut dhanyavad. Samadhur aur Shivani ko bhi bahut bahut dhanyavad. Ye abhi tak un logon ke support se hum log itni webinar kar paaye. Thanks. Thanks very much. We will be giving travel to you again on the relevant topic, sir. Thank you, Suhas ji. Thank you very much.